Dear brothers and sisters in the Dhamma, Namo Buddhaya, Jai Bhim. So, of course, we've been very much aware of Baba Saheb's great contribution to the transformation of the lives of so many people. And we've been aware of his empowerment of people through conversion. We've seen people around us who have been so transformed. And we've discussed yesterday the theme of breaking down barriers. And we've seen that especially in the context of breaking down caste barriers. So our theme today is Dhamma and governance. And this is a subject on which Baba Saheb has completely unique things to say. Buddhism traditionally has addressed government, but government has always been in the form of monarchy or of hierarchical government. So for instance, the Aganya Sutta, the Buddha addresses the theme of the Dhammachakra Pravartin Raja, the wheel-turning monarch. And his advice is mainly moral. There's a little bit in the Vajja Sutta, which is advice to the Vajjian Confederacy, probably a male oligarchy with a semi-democratic dimension. But on the whole, what he's got to say is to the government in the form of monarchy. And that's been the universal case throughout history, so far as I'm aware. We know of Nagarjuna's Surlekha, which is advice to a king. And again, it's moral advice. It's advising the king to practice the Dhamma and rule on the basis of the Dhamma, on the basis of Dhammic principles. In the 20th century, democracy has developed as a worldwide phenomenon. Unfortunately, not a universal worldwide phenomenon, but I don't know the proportion, but a huge number of people on this planet live under democracy. And Dr. Ambedkar, Baba Saheb, is the first person that I'm aware of, and the first person of such statesman-like stature to address the question of what is the relevance of Dhamma to democracy. So I think that he has something distinctive and new to say. I know nobody, maybe my ignorance, who has addressed this question so squarely, and certainly nobody so distinguished who knew what he was talking about because he'd written the constitution of a whole huge nation. So Baba Saheb had a great deal of respect, and he saw for democracy and saw democracy as an ideal of relationship between human beings, of reverence and respect of one citizen for another. That's how essentially he saw democracy. He saw it as fraternity. But he himself was quite disillusioned fairly quickly, even with India under the constitution that he wrote. And after the failure of the Hindu Code Bill, which bitterly, bitterly disappointed him, when proper human rights for women were rejected at that time. They've since been instituted in India, but at that time they rejected it, bitterly disillusioned him. And he said famously, "We built this wonderful temple," I'm not quoting, but he said more or less, "We built this wonderful temple of the constitution so that some god can dwell in it, some wonderful god can dwell in it." Of course, he's speaking metaphorically, I assure you. But a devil has taken residence in it. So Baba Saheb was very well aware that democracy is a form which is as good as those who exercise it. And I think this is something very, very important for us to examine. How do we move to make that ideal form of democracy into real, genuine democracy? That very great wit, Winston Churchill, had a famous saying about democracy. He said, "It has been said that democracy is the worst form of government, except all those other forms that have been tried from time to time." And this is very apt. Democracy has many, many faults. And we're very well aware, not democracy has many faults, but the exercise of democracy has many faults. And we're well aware that of those faults, especially today. After all, Hitler was voted into power, or at least was the majority, no, sorry, the democratic constitution allowed him to enter power. Mussolini entered power with the democratic backing. They soon modified it. And of course, Mussolini and Hitler have some good reputation in India, we're astonished to find. And indeed, Mussolini's fascist black shirts were a model for a certain large national movement, which Indians will know what I'm referring to. Right at the start, we have to admit that democracy is vulnerable. And it's very vulnerable to being taken over by sectional interests who grab hold of the machinery of power and use them for their own benefit. And the worst thing is what they do is manipulate people's gullibility. They find what people want, they tell them what they want, then they're in power and they start to work on that. And it has the effect of being, usually the approach is populist, authoritarian, socially conservative, because that's a concern of many people, narrowly nationalist, basically it's fascism. And it often goes with crony capitalism, so that the capitalist forces are integrated into government. You know, we think of, on the right, Putin, Orban, Erdogan, etc. I'm not going to name every name. Indians will have their own ideas. British people will have their own ideas. Let each of us speak about our own nation. And of course, there's a similar thing on the left, and I'm not going to go through names there, but we can think of populist authoritarianism of the left as well as the right. On the democratic basis, using what the people want to hear to get into power and then capture it. And often what you see is that it's famously been said that the governments that people vote for is like turkeys voting for Christmas. That's a Christian analogy. Or we could say, for Indians' sake, it's like goats voting for Bakr Id. So democracy is vulnerable, deeply vulnerable. And Baba Sahib saw this so clearly and therefore enunciated a sort of theory of democracy which I believe has yet to be absorbed worldwide. I'm not going to follow exactly the way in which Baba Sahib lays it out. I'm going to give you an interpretive account of it, which I hope my dear brothers and sisters from India will forgive me for if I get things wrong. I'm sure I'll be told quite quickly. The sons and daughters of Dr. Ambedkar are very careful to guard his name. So I'm going to ask for the first slide to be put up, please. So before we look at, I hope you can see that, it's a bit light, isn't it? But before we look at the dynamics of good government, Dhammarajya, we're going to first look at the fundamental Dhammic perspective on the dynamics of mind. So if we start at the bottom, we've got view, a basic attitude to life, a basic attitude to the world, our idea of ourselves, our idea of the world, view, drishti, ditti. And that, of course, can be ignorant or wise. So on the basis of that view, that fundamental attitude, which is often, of course, satkaya drishti, or satkaya ditti in Pali, and there are equivalents in the Mahayana traditions, atma kleshas, and so on, that manifests in mental states. Those mental states are pure or defiled. They're skillful or unskillful. And those mental states lead to action in the world. And that action is skillful or unskillful. So we've got this triple relationship between underlying attitude, view, mental state, and action, which is the basis, really, of Buddhist ethics and of Buddhist soteriological theory. So next slide, please. So let's look at how the dynamics of mind work in terms of government. It's very obvious. This is not rocket science, and I'm not really saying anything that you don't already know. But at the bottom of it, we've got the voters' views, attitudes, and ideas. Like yesterday, there was a question about the exclusion of women. Well, that happens because of underlying views, attitudes, and ideas. Of course, underneath those views, attitudes, and ideas is the most basic of those views, attitudes, and ideas, which is clinging to self, satkaya ditti, or all the other equivalents. So voters' views, attitudes, and ideas determine, well, their mental states, the state of mind with which they view current problems, the emotional responses they have to current situations and responses. They're all sort of based on something much more fundamental, something much more intrinsic that's been kind of built in from the moment that we're conceived. So those mental states then determine the choices that voters make, which cross, where they put their cross, because they put their cross where they think their views and their feelings will be best served, will be best worked out. And then the democratic constitution shapes how that manifests in a particular government. So you've got that very clear relationship between fundamental attitudes, and I mean really fundamental, not philosophical ideas, or those manifest it, but attitudes that, and assumptions we don't even know we've got, that boil over is a good term for it, into certain mental states. As things happen, we have immediate responses and reactions, and that boils over into the choices we make. When we hear a certain politician speak about, well, let's be nice and non-controversial, because I'm sure everybody will understand, building a wall to keep out Mexicans, to bow to the Americans. You are American, are you? No, sorry. Oh, I'm terribly sorry. Oh, dear. Anyway, you know what I mean.
We have our own walls. Huh? We've built our own walls.
You've got your own. Oh, gosh, you're not American at all. So, this is what is being promulgated in the election in America at the moment. So, and we've got our own equivalents in Britain, of course, just so I'm not seen to be pushing my own nationalist point of view. So, yes, those come out of, when the politician says that, accords with feelings that people have and with the views that underlie those feelings. So they put their cross in that particular box. And the Constitution is shaped to take the views and to assimilate them into a majority position, which forms the government. The government then is guided by the policies which it attracted votes through. Of course, the government then continues to manipulate the views and attitudes of people underlying. So it's a circle. Actually, it's a nirvana chain. You could work this out in terms of a wheel of government, a bhava chakra of government. So the government deliberately starts to manipulate views and attitudes. So, for instance, they modify history books. I know this is happening in India today. It happens in many countries. History books are rewritten to make sure that people have the attitudes and ideas that the government supports itself upon, and that will lead voters to vote for them again. So there's a continuous cycle between these processes, which of course builds up to each election and then continues over the next 5 years or 7 years or whatever it is that the Constitution dictates. So this is what Barbara said meant. However good the democratic Constitution is, the views, attitudes, and ideas of people determine their mental states, determine their choices, and therefore determines the government. This is the devil, or the god, metaphorically, who lives in the Constitution. So, next slide. Let's have a look at how this works out in terms of Dhammarajya. There's something missing at the bottom there, which is Dhamma, the truth, the way things really are, the fundamental truth about the nature of reality. On that basis, a moral revolution takes place. On the basis of the Dhamma, a moral revolution takes place which changes the way people view things, changes their mental states, and therefore leads to them making choices that are based on that moral position, based on that wisdom to the extent that they have it, or at least on the basis of that right view, which then, through the democratic constitution, leads to a government that is based in the principles of the Dhamma and based in moral attitudes. That is, in Baba Saheb's term, Dhammarajya, the rule of Dhamma. This is the fundamental nidana chain here, the spiral, if you like, of nidanas. If we can change people's understanding, if we can change their attitudes, that will mean they lead, or if we can change our understanding and our attitudes, that will lead to voters making choices that, through the democratic constitution, lead to a fair and just society governed by people with principle. The question is, how do we bring about that revolution, that moral revolution, that revolution in ideas? It's not the job of government to do that. But may we be saved from governments trying to change our ideas, because governments then taint their efforts with their own power interest. So who is to do that? Well, brothers and sisters, we have to do it. And we have to do it in the context of Sangha. So my last slide, please. If this moral revolution is to take place, if there is to be a transformation in attitudes, fundamental ideas about life, and in moral perspective, then there needs to be an agent of that change, of that moral revolution. It's not going to happen by itself. And good. I thought I'd put something there I didn't know about. I thought I was going to learn something. It's Sangha that is the agent of that moral revolution. Sangha, we define as the community of all who go for refuge to the three jewels. Fundamentally, it consists of every man, every woman who commits themselves to practicing the Dhamma in harmony with others in order to move towards enlightenment. In my own understanding, and this is the position of our order, this fundamental going for refuge to the three jewels is much more important than how we choose to live that out. We talk of our own order as neither lay nor monastic, because we think that these categories are no longer easily applicable under the circumstances of a modern liberal democratic society. For instance, I am wearing a white keser, which means that I'm not celibate. My friend Parami is wearing a yellow keser, which orange keser, which means gold keser, sorry, which means she's an anagarika. She's taken a vow of celibacy. But of course, Parami is much more committed than me, but that's a matter of her personal qualities rather than of her status, if you see what I mean. So we don't accord special status to those who make that vow. We think that it's important that people are known by their worth rather than their lifestyle choice. We think that lifestyle of celibacy and renunciation is extremely valuable, but people can live that out in very different ways. I hardly ever get to go to my home. I'm working really hard for the Dhamma. Not hard enough, I know. But I'm working hard for the Dhamma. My life is dedicated to the Dhamma. It's hard to say what I am. In a way, I'm neither lay nor monastic. This is the way we see it. We realize others view it differently, and You know, we respect different views, even if we don't agree. What Sangha really means is deep friendship between people within a particular Sangha on the basis of going for refuge to the three jewels. So we feel we share the most fundamental ideals, and we share our commitment to those ideals in a very living, practical, communicative way. And we try to work together to manifest those ideals in our own lives and for the benefit of others. That's our understanding of Sangha. Of course, that can embrace different interpretations of Sangha too. But fundamentally, we think that Sangha is going for refuge to the three jewels in friendship, in harmony, with shared values. We think that, Sangha is a moral agent in society to bring about that fundamental revolution in attitudes and ideas and in moral behavior is the task of Sangha. Sangha is there to spread this new attitude. It's not government. We don't want government to try. It's not their job. What we want is that a large number of people within society commit themselves to the three jewels, form Sangha together, come into deep connection and contact with each other, and work for the benefit of others. So the duty of the Sangha, first of all, is it has no duty. The Sangha needs no justification. It exists in its own right. The existence of the Sangha is its own meaning. The Sangha as a real deep connection between people based on the principles of the three jewels is a value in itself. But the Sangha does have an active role to play in the betterment of the world. And that is, first of all, providing moral and dhammic training for others within society. That's what we do here at Nagaloka. Nagaloka is a manifestation of our order. It's a manifestation of the vision of our founder and teacher, Urgyen Sangharakshita. And order members work together through Nagaloka, and they work in other areas, in other ways, in other contexts, in order to train people to go for refuge to the three jewels more and more deeply, more and more effectively. So that's a very important function of the Sangha, to spread the ideals of the Dhamma throughout society so that the attitudes of voters change. Then the Sangha provides a safe space for those who want to live morally. It's a great dilemma, I know, in India. If you want to live morally, how can you do so in a violent and unjust society? And what the Sangha provides is a space within which you can live out your ideals, even though you can't always do so within the wider society. So it's a very, very important function. If you don't have that safe space where you know that you can rely broadly on people's integrity and their ability to take you in as one who commits themselves to the three jewels, what are you to do? It's a lonely, difficult task. Only the Buddha managed that. And of course, we know we're not perfect. The Sangha is not perfect. It's made up of people who are striving for perfection, who are striving to live out the ideals. And that's the third thing. The Sangha provides an example for the whole of society of trying to live together on the basis of liberty, equality, and fraternity. So in Baba Saheb's definition of a just society, that we live together without violence towards each other, leaving each other free to come to our own choices and decisions, in equality without imposing artificial hierarchical barriers between us, and in fraternity, that is in Maitri. This is how Baba Saheb defined Bandhutva, fraternity, as Maitri. So the Sangha has the function of giving people the courage to live like that. If you don't see Sangha, you think it can't be done. It's a nice idea, wonderful, wonderful dream, but you can't live it out. We need to see what society could be like, or something closer to what society could be like, if we are to have the courage to transform ourselves. And so through the existence of the Sangha, if it's widely enough represented, it has an uplifting effect upon the whole society. And this, I believe, is our common task, to create that Sangha that can be provide moral and spiritual training, dhammic training for everybody in society, that can be a safe space for those who want to live a just and free life, and as an example to the wider society. That, if we can make that widely enough influential, I don't know what percentage it would require, but if we can make that widely enough influential, attitudes would change, and voters would make different choices, and we would have Dhammaraja. Namo Buddhaya, Jai Bhim.